doing what to join the garden.
Very good, said Charles.
Friends at the CCH 1894. What do you make of it, Watson?
Well, applying your methods, though I'm sure I can never equal them, I say that because the stick is scratched on the bottom, the man likes to take long walks and he lives in the country. Therefore, CCH stands for Country Club Hunt. And because such a gift is generally given upon retirement, I say the fellow is a successful elderly medical man who has lived in the country his entire life and is obviously well beloved by his friends.
Excellent, Watson. Truly remarkable.
Am I correct, though?
No, you're completely wrong.
Really?
But you inspire me, Watson. Like John Bassett, you are not only witty in yourself, but because that wit is in other men. In point of fact, as the king tells us, our Dr. Mortimer's young man, under 30, who used to work at the Charing Cross Hospital, CCH, here in London. He has lived in the country for the past 5 years, and he's amiable, unambitious, absent-minded, and the possessor of a favorite medium-sized dog.
Oh, Mr. Holmes, sometimes I think I'm married. If you didn't have such filthy habits.
Ooh, cripe, isn't Mrs. Hudson. A parlor, he is a doctor, Mortimer, so it must be Charing Cross Hospital. And seeing as the date on the stick is 5 years old, nobody would leave such a fine practice if they were well established, so he must have been a student there. And seeing as the date on the stick is 5 years old, we have a young fellow under 30.
And the rest of it?
Well, the scratches on the cane can confirm that he does in fact live in the country now. And it is my experience that only amiable men receive testimonials. Only unambitious ones abandon them. And only absent-minded ones eat their sticks and not their visiting cards.
Go! And what about the dog?
Oh, well, look at the marks. Being a heavy stick, the dog is held tightly in between. The dog's jaw is shown by these marks as too broad for a terrier, but too narrow for a mastiff. It may have been... Ah, yes, it is a curly-haired spaniel.
Holmes, please. How could you possibly know that?
Because I'm looking out the window and see the dog on our doorstep now. Ah, and there's the ring of its owner. Mrs. Hudson, the door, please.
Right away, sir.
Now is the dramatic moment of fatalism. When you hear the step upon the stair of someone entering your life, and you know whether or not for good or for ill, what does Dr. Mortimer man of science, Astor Sherlock Holmes, specialist in crime. And can he relieve this team of our mortal existence? Look, come in.
My stick! What a relief. I'm a musical world.
A presentation, I see.
Indeed, from Charing Cross Hospital when I moved to the country as a student at the time. I take it I'm addressing Mr. Sherlock Holmes?
Yes, and this is my friend, Dr. Watson.
How do you do?
Ah, and this is Mrs. Hudson.
How do you do, sir?
Tea, Mrs. Hudson.
Quite well, sir.
Oh, of course. Right away, sir. Shall I begin, sir?
Please.
I have here a manuscript.
Mid-18th century. Ooh, what a lesson to forgery.
1742, to be exact. Handed down for over a century and committed to me for safekeeping by my dear friend Sir Charles Baskerville, whose sudden death 3 weeks ago created so much excitement in Devonshire. It appears to be stable of some sort. May I read it to you?
Please, have a seat.
On the origins of the Hound of the Baskervilles.
Huh?
Know then that at the time of the Great Rebellion, the Manor of Baskerville was held by one Sir Hugo, of a most wild, profane, and godless nature. Now, it chanced this Hugo came to love the daughter of a yeoman who held lands near Baskerville, but the maiden feared his evil ways and would ever avoid him. Well, it came to pass that one likeness, this Hugo, along with 5 or 6 of his wicked companions, stole down upon the farm of the maiden and carried her off. And as they arrived at Baskerville Hall, the maiden was placed in an upper chamber.
No! Stop it, please!
My God!
Ah!
While Hugo and his friend sat down for a long carouse, as was their custom. Now, the poor lass upstairs was like to have her wits turned by the singing and the shouting. And in the stress of fear, she did that which would have daunted even the bravest of men. For by the aid of the ivy which covered the south wall, she came down from the eaves and so began homeward across the moor. Now it chanced some small time later, Hugo found the cage empty and the bird escaped. Whereupon, he rushed down the stairs, sprang up on the table and cried,
"If I do not overtake that witch this very night, I shall rid up my bodies and power of evil. Now saddle my mare and cover my pack and put the hound upon her."
Hardly could have sworn to his identity. There was certainly no physical injury of any kind. hand. While no disturbance near the body, there were marks on the ground several yards away. Footprints? Footprints.
A man or a woman's?
Mr. Holmes, they were the footprints of a gigantic hound.
You saw us?
Clearly.
And you said nothing?
What was the use?
Well, how is it that no one else saw it?
The marks were 20 or so yards away from the body.
There are sheepdogs on the wall.
This was no sheepdog.
Oh, you say it was large?
Enormous.
Oh, only if I had been there. You should have sent for me.
I didn't think of it. Besides,
what is it? You hesitate.
There were incidents before the tragedy. Several people saw a creature upon the moor which corresponds exactly with the basketball demon of legend. A creature from a nightmare, with blazing eyes and dripping jaws. My friends, there was such a running terror in the district that no one will even cross the moor at night.
How can we assist you?
By advising you what I should do with Sir Henry Baskerville, who arrives at Waterloo Station in exactly 1 hour.
He's there?
Yes, he's an American from Texas. Why not take him to the home of his fathers? But consider the history, the danger. What can I do?
Well, first, I advise you to call off your Spaniard. And scratching at my door with the zeal of a Christian. Then take a cab, collect Sir Henry.
And then?
Return here tomorrow morning at 10, Sir Henry, and I will suggest how to proceed. Good morning, go quickly.
Goodbye.
I like it, Watson. There's a feverish quality to this unlikely tale that appeals to me. Are you going out?
Unless I can help you in some way.
Oh, no, no, dear friend. But when you pass Bradley's, would you ask him to send up a pound of his strongest shag tobacco?
This was the moment when everything changed. Holmes had smelled the bait, and I sensed we were on the verge of another one of his strange roller coaster adventures. I also knew that tobacco was the engine he required at these moments of intense mental concentration. So I stopped at Bradley's.
That'll be 2 and 6 pence for the best shag tobacco in the country. Ah.
I had it sent around, then returned that evening.
Cough, cold, dear friend.
No, it's poisonous atmosphere.
As a doctor, you will admit that smoking is good for the health.
You know I have written blows on things. Now, how's the case coming?
There are certainly some points of distinction about it. That change in footprints, for example. What do you make of that?
Mortimer said the victim began walking off tiptoe at some point.
He was running, Watson. Running for his life until his heart burst and he fell dead on the spot.
Running from what?
There lies our problem. There are indications the man was literally crazed with fear.
His face of you?
That, I believe something dangerous approached him from across the moor. Only a man who's lost his wits would run from the house instead of towards it. But who was he waiting for that night? And why was he waiting in the yew alley instead of inside the house? Ooh, the thing takes its shape, Watson. It becomes coherent. Come, it shall have to be late.
For what?
For the opera. Nothing like a little musical mayhem to clear the mind.
Acting out the kind of ruthless manner that had become part.
How are they, are you nice?
So you've had a remarkable experience, then?
I wouldn't call it remarkable, exactly. Just this eyeball litter that arrived at my hotel was joined.
To Sir Henry Baskerville, Northumberland Hotel. Who knew you were staying in the Northumberland?
No one could possibly know.
Except yourself.
Well, yes, but we had only decided to stay there after we met at the station.
Except this last one. As you value your life or your reason, keep away from the moor. I take it you've told Sir Henry about the hound.
Yes, I have.
And it sounds like a load of hogwash to me. A big old hound who bleeds it out of the grave fire! Hell, I got hounds at home that will eat them for breakfast and spit out the bones.
Watson, do we have a copy of yesterday's Times? There's an interesting article on the front page about free trade. Listen carefully. You will see that it stands to reason that your terrorists will keep away wealth from the life of the country.
I'm getting a little bit on trail here.
On the contrary, I'm hot on the trail. Listen to the words from this article. You, your, life, reason, keep away from me. Now, listen to the words from this letter. You, your, life, reason, keep away from me. The words were cut out of a copy of this newspaper.
Oh, that's remarkable! How did you know that?
Oh, please, Doctor, it's my profession. I know the print of every newspaper in the country. Though I will confess that once, when I was very young, I confused the Dover Express with the Oxford Mercury. Oh, I couldn't leave the house for weeks.
Okay, so why is the word more written out by hand?
The word is less common and therefore hard to find in print.
Well done, Watson.
Thank you, Max.
Now, tell me, gentlemen, have you two observed anyone following you this morning?
Holy cow, I think I walked straight to a dime now. Look at that.
I see no one.
The point remains whether Sir Henry should go to Devonshire or not.
Oh, no, it don't remain. That is my property now. Oh, 10,000 acres of it, and I give it up for no one.
Then listen to what I say, and listen closely. You two will walk back to your hotel at a brisk but not unreasonable pace. Then, Dr. Watson and I will join you for lunch at 1. Good morning, go quickly.
I gotta confess, I don't quite...
Do not question me! Go now.
We shall see you later.
Quickly, Watson, your hat was a moment to lose.
What's the matter? Shall I stop then?
Not for the world, your friend. We'll follow you in about 50 yards. Now, quickly, quickly, into the street. Them in view.
There they are.
Oh, ooh, stay low. That's natural.
Holmes, look. A strong window.
Oh, tuck in the storm. Do you see that cab? The one with the man inside. The one with the large hat. He told it on the other side of the street. And now it's moving slowly forward again. It's following Sir Henry for Clamorton.
Oh, I say, he's got us!
Get back!
To bed!
Move!
There he goes!
What's in find at the cab immediately?
Taxi! Taxi!
Have her the cab, for God's sake! Ah, I'm an adult, an idiot. My God, I'm a baby in the woods. But I trust that if you're an honest friend, you're right about this blunder of mine in your memoirs alone and all of the successes you'd be writing about.
Who was the man?
I have no idea.
But how did you know
he... Watson, please, it was evident from all we heard this morning that Sir Henry had been close to the shadow since arriving in London. I just thought his pursuer would be on foot, not in a cab.
It's a pity we didn't get the number.
Watson, as clumsy as I've been, you don't think I can watch you with the number, do you? Come quickly. I have an idea. Ah, yes, there it is, the messenger office. Let's go inside.
The odds are enormously against your fear.
and I would like a report as soon as possible.
Yes, sir. You got it, sir.
And may I say, what a pleasure to enter your employment, Mr. Holmes.
And you, Dr. Watson.
And now,
like a runaway horse,
or a speeding train,
or a thwarted leopard,
or a cheating bar,
or a phantom,
or a ghost,
or a bullet,
or sound.
We're up! Come, Watson. We're due at the Northumberland Hotel, and I know a desk clerk there. She's a Castilian.
That's a lot of money. Yes, it is.
Anyways.
He left
£40,000.
Quite enough money to provoke a murder, don't you think?
The Dyke Mortimer told me the amount of legacy Tom was not a shaker.
And if something were to happen to Sir Henry, who would inherit?
I've heard talk of Black Sheep's son, Sir Charles's brother, Roger, but I do believe he died some years ago in South America.
And you're unmarried?
Yep.
No children?
Well, I sure hope not, but I can't spare you, you know?
Have you made a will?
No.
Well, I agree that you should go to Devonshire and claim your inheritance, but there is only one proviso. You must not go alone.
Dr. Mortimer is gone with me.
Dr. Mortimer has his practice to attend to, and I presume your house is not near the manor.
4 miles away.
There you are. You must take someone trustworthy who will stay by your side.
Could you come yourself?
No, I'm afraid I can't. There's a scandal threatening the King of Bohemia that requires my attention. But if my friend would agree, we would have no better companion, nor any friendlier.
Me? I say that's a kind way to put it.
And it would be off the gallery, Doctor, if you're up for it.
Well, not really sure I'm the person for it, but I'll do it.
Oh, excellent.
Okay.
The matter's concluded then. When shall we depart?
Shall we say Paddington Station today at 4?
Done.
You will write me frequently and inform the facts. You are my eyes and ears, and I must know everything. Now, I've made some inquiries and found that a man has escaped from Princetown Prison, which is close to Baskerville, and he is said to be dangerous. Also, there's a man named Stapleton living nearby with his sister, as well as the butler and his wife, of whom I hear rather sinister rumors. And of course, our friend, Dr. Morgan, who I believe to be honest part of whom we know very little.
You should be more trusting, Holmes.
Oh, I'd be much more trusting if he had inherited £10,000. On which theory we should add Sir Henry to our little gallery.
Oh, I don't believe that. He's so American.
Well, he inherited close to £1,000,000 and someone killed Sir Charles Baskerville.
Oh, wait, excuse me. Are you two the owners of the house at 221B Baker Street? That's right. I heard you wanted some work for the driver of the cab number 27 or 4. Now, what you got against me?
No, I have nothing against you, madam. On the contrary, I'll have to stop you for you if you'll answer some questions.
Well, I'm having a good day, aren't I? How can I help you?
Tell me about the man with the large hat who watched my house at 10 this morning, then followed two men down Raymond Street.
Now, what's the good of me telling you? You know as much as I do already. Don't tell me he's the detective. Now, I was to keep you trapped shut, as it were. My good woman, this is serious business, and you'll find yourself in a bad position if you try to hide anything.
Now, tell me where you picked him up and all that occurred.
Well, this gentleman only at 1:30 in Chapelwood Square this morning. He offered me two guineas if I could do as he said. First, we drove down to Northumberland and waited there until two gents came out, and then we followed them until they stopped to Chocolate.
And then?
They came out of there and we followed them again, only this time my gent sees you, and he throws up the trap and he cries, "Oh, you damn, that is Ken! Why do you stop?"
who I was on Regent Street, assumed I would find the driver of the cab, then sent me back this audacious message. Oh, I tell you, this time we have a firm and well of our steel.
The man is bored, nothing else.
The man is a creature of tenement who is weaving a web whose intricacies we bear glimpse.
I'm afraid I'm not easy about sending you on this dangerous errand. You have your revolver, I suppose.
Yes, I thought I was. Take it with me.
Good. Keep it by you night and day, and never relax your precautions. Ah, Dr. Morgan, Sir Henry, right on time.
Well, if this ain't an adventure, I don't know what is.
Did you find your boots?
He did not. I suppose it's gone forever.
Hmm. How very peculiar. Now, Sir Henry, listen to what I say and follow my instructions to the letter.
Instructions?
You will avoid the moor in the hours of darkness at all costs. It is a landscape that will try to seduce you with its morbid beauty. Also, never leave the house without Watson. Is that clear?
Well, I'll try, but I sure don't like being pinned up.
Good luck to all. Watson?
I looked back at the platform and we had left it far behind and saw the tall, austere figure of Holmes standing motionless and gazing after us. I felt alone, yet I was on my mettle to do my best for Holmes. And, certainly, knowing full well and without the rest,
Griffin Station! All out for Griffin!
Ugh, what? Ugh, that was quick.
Sir, you were there in the trap. Could you take us to Battleford Hall for a shilling?
Battleford Hall? Are you sure you want to go to Ingvella?
Well, yes, I am.
Fair enough. Climb aboard. If it doesn't kill you, it'll make you stronger. I believe I'll meet you, put it. Knowing it? Don't go.
Giddy up! You can see the through the walls of Devonshire, a landscape of such desolation and despair, that we may as well have been visiting another dark planet, where the limbs, the trunk, the very heart of nature were filled with malevolence. My heart grieved for the world around me, and then I saw it. In its dark, forbidding glory, Baskerville Hall.
Holy cow! Talk about gloomy. Reminds me of my mom's funeral. Without all the liquor, of course, you.
Yeah.
You're leaving?
When it is convenient, sir.
But your family's been here for generations. I'd be sorry to begin my life here by breaking the connection.
We were very attached to Sir Charles, sir, and his untimely death has made these surroundings very painful for us. May we show you two to your rooms?
You're welcome this way. The water is beautiful.
Yes.
This one is of Sir Hugo, the one who saw the native in the 1800s. They said his throat was chewed out by a giant dog. This is not a very good way to die. The bedroom. Aha! It's lovely. The view.
Pardon?
W. Ah, yes, the view. The vista.
Of course.
No. It seems so lonely. You must be glad to have some company to attend.
Not so much!
My dear Herbert.
I'm so sorry for the infrequent bulletins, but I've slept little since arriving at Baskerville Hall. You know that I am a creature of the Enlightenment, and have not been the blot of dramatic romanticism. But on several nights in a row, I have heard in the distance the muffled, strangled gasps of one who is torn by an uncontrollable sorrow. Meanwhile, Sir Henry remains in surprisingly good spirits.
Y'all got anything out here I can shoot?
And we intend to explore the neighborhood tomorrow morning.
Spots all scattered around.
Yes, they seem more fertile than most of
us. Fertile? That's the great Griffin Meyer.
The Griffin Meyer?
What a false statement, except for any man or beast. Only yesterday I saw one of the more ponies wander into it. He never came out. I saw his neck for quite a long time craning out of the bog hole, then his riding neck shot upwards, and it sucked him down at last.
But why have you ever been near the Griffin Meyer?
Because that's where the specimens are. And that's what I do for a thing. Here it is. The great Sir Proxies. Please, I will be long. Get back here, you little
devil! You want it for the grip? The wire, for God's sake!
What? Back! Go straight back to London instantly!
Why should I go back?
You can't explain. For God's sake, do what I ask you.
But I've just come.
Can't you tell the warning is for your own good? Stop tonight. Get away from this place at all. Who back, please, listen to me! Save yourself a minute!
What are you waiting for?
Christmas, get up here!
Where's your son? Here I am.
Took you so long.
You have no idea.
Now, first things first. What happened at the Times? Did you find the copy with the cut-out letters?
No, sir. No luck. But we did have fun with the bill. All that trash!
As I suspected. Now, reading Dr. Watson's letter. Curse my experiments. Curse explosives, and curse the day I ever needed my eyes in the first place. That or Australia, the doctor could put them on me. Now read.
Whoops. It isn't Dr. Watson after all. It's from one of your many, many beautiful girlfriends. In fact, I think it's a tall one with the silky.
Is this your idea of humor, Cartwright?
Yes, it was.
It was. Then.
Sorry. From Dr. Jane Watson to Mr. Sherlock Holmes. My dear Holmes, my previous letters have kept you pretty well up to date so far, but there's a new development to add to the mosaic that you and I are so carefully assembling, which is very good writing.
My turn. Our friend Sir Henry begins to display a considerable interest in our neighbor, Miss Stapleton. It is not to be wondered at, for she is a very fascinating and beautiful woman.
Ugh, it's revolting. There's something quite exotic about her, and Sir Henry says she has hidden flowers buried deep inside her bosom.
Bosom?
That's it, I can stand it no longer. Eyes, eyes, I mean, my eyes. He was silhouetted in the moonlight, and I could see his wild figure standing quite still at first, then capering over the rocks like a sprite. I have begun to think of him as the man of mystery. How curious.
Yes, curious, all right. Very curious.
Gives me curiosity.
And wonder.
And surprise.
And think.
That's enough! I saw the man from a distance several nights in a row, but I have not seen him for the past 2 days. He comes and goes and seems to melt almost madly into the landscape. Watson, she is our better self. And now let me tell you more about the Barrymores. The Barrymores. The surprising development began last night. As you know, I am a very sound sleeper, but at 2 in the morning, I was aroused by a stealthy step passing my room. I got out of bed and saw a shadow in the hall. A man in the hall, so I thought. My instinct was to follow him alone, which I felt better at, and crept into Sir Henry's room down the hall and woke him quietly.
Sir Henry, wake up!
What? Holy cow! I thought I was being murdered in my bed! Oh, Billy,
something strange is occurring. Follow me.
You got it.
I was, looking for your crate.
Oh, baloney! Now listen to me, Barrymore. I'm up to you, Daddy. What were you doing at that window?
Don't ask me, Sir Henry. Please, I give you my word that it is not my secret.
Wait a moment. I have an idea. He must have been signaling someone. Let's see if there's an answer in that. Look, there it is. An answer in light after the hall.
Now, you bitch. You did not have it to signal. Who's that out there? And what's going on? Tell me! Tell me right now!
I don't tell you!
Enough.
It's my brother! My brother's out there starving on the floor! His light signals for when the victual's already! His signal tells us where to bring them!
Then your brother is?
podcast. Come on. Let's go, Tate.
I agree.
Surprised.
Holmes, what are you?
Just checking up on you, Watson.
I'm fine.
You are not fine. As I understand it, you were almost killed by that brute on the moor. Perhaps you should leave the case entirely. It's getting too dangerous.
Never. I intend to see it to the end.
There are layers here, Watson. Layers on layers, and nothing adds up. On the one hand, there's this Victor fellow who's obviously violent, but comes out of the blue.
Supplies!
Although he is connected to the Baskervilles through his sister, and I suppose Sir Charles and Mrs. Berrymore could have had a liaison that he was out to explore revenge.
With Mrs. Berrymore? Oh, I doubt it. She's like something out of Frankenstein.
You'd be surprised. And then there's Mary, husband, who's a bit peculiar.
is harmless as far as I can see. Unless, of course, his wife and Sir Charles did have an affair. He could have killed Sir Charles out of revenge, but I don't see how to threaten Sir Henry. Unless, of course, Barrymore's a maniac. Which is not impossible. And, of course, we have Stapleton, who is obviously mad as a hatter, but has nothing to gain as far as I can see. Oh, and his sister, Beryl, who could be the worst of the lot and is simply pretending to be the sole innocence.
Don't tell Sir Henry that. He's besotted with her.
All the more reason to worry. She could be using him to get the money.
Huh?
Has anything else turned up? Any sign of the hound?
No, but you know that man of mystery I wrote you about? I saw him up close the other night.
You did?
Yes. I was taking a final look round the grounds before going back to bed, and there he was, standing along to the back. He comes and goes like a phantom. Mm.
Is he anything like our friend, Victor?
No, no. Different type entirely. This fellow seems older and slightly out of his head, the way he mutters and gibbers and shambles along. When you see him, he can show you a great deal more.
Oh, well, I won't have a traitor.
Why not?
Because I'm leaving.
What? Again, you can't.
I'm sorry.
But Holmes,
I can't possibly stay. Press of work. Bohemia business.
But you just arrived.
I'm sorry.
Have you seen Sir Henry at least?
Whoa. No, no, no. I don't want to. It'll only make a fuss. I just wanted to make sure you weren't dead or something.
Well, I'm not.
Apparently. Now, listen closely. I want you to stay and keep me informed. Also, keep a closer eye on Sir Henry.
Right.
Hey, Doctor!
There he is.
All yours.
Now, Holmes, wait just a moment.
Doctor!
I'm coming! Ah, okay, Holmes.
Hey, Doctor. I'll see you later. I'm going out by myself for a spill. Well, to tell you the truth, I'm going out to meet Pharaoh.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Stop! Suddenly, stop! You know what Holmes said. You may not go out to the mall to unaccompany, and that is final.
Listen, I've got two answers for you. First of all, we've been through a lot together, so you got to stop calling me Sir Henry. It's Henry, and I'll call you Janie.
Jane.
Okay, Jane Doe or Bubba?
Jane Doe.
You got it. Second of all, Mr. Holmes, in all his wisdom, did not foresee certain, romantic developments, which have transpired since I've been here. And I've been doing this fool's sport, right? So you just sit right here, take a nap, and I'll see you later.
No, no, stop! Stop! Would you please?
Don't move.
Thank you. found me a different own box. I thought it better if he didn't see me.
Oh, that's all right. But why in the world do you think he acts like that? I mean, do you think he's crazy?
I suppose it's possible.
I think he needs a straitjacket. I mean, what's he got against me anyway? I got plenty of money, and I never hurt anyone.
Sir Henry,
shh, don't say a word.
Please, sir, I've come to apologize. I suppose I overreacted.
Oh, you suppose that, do you?
Please, sir, you must understand. We've been together, just the two of us, since we were children, and I didn't understand you two had fallen in love. I do apologize, I'm deeply sorry.
Well, that's very clear.
Perhaps he didn't dine with us this Friday. I could make amends, but I must ask you one thing even now, and that is, please let matters rest until then, at which time I can get used to the idea and withdraw any opposition to the match without hesitation. That is a promise.
Well, I suppose a few days ain't too bad.
Wonderful. We'll see you Friday.
Thank you.
one of us? Or shall we settle it over a nice cup of tea, my dear Watson?
Holmes?
Hello, dear friend.
Was it you all along?
I'm afraid it was, and I'm glad you applied your usual pungent shade of cream this morning. I wouldn't have known it was you in the night.
Oh, my dear, it's good to see you.
I'm surprised you found me this soon.
Mortimer saw you stumbling on the rocks.
And you've just been this evening to find Lord Leon, haven't you?
Yes, but what are you doing here? I thought you were Main Street working on the blackmailing case.
That's what I wished you'd think. I thought if we could explore the case independently from two different angles, we could make more progress. I'm currently trying to track down this Miss Leon.
Well, I think I've done it. Mortimer says she lives down on Cross Street.
Oh, excellent. Well done. You're getting better at this detective business than I am. I should take up doctoring soon.
Oh, I say.
Now, I take it your next move is to visit this Laura Leon.
Exactly.
Good. Then we'll go together. You are aware that close intimacy exists between her and the man stated.
No, I'm not.
They meet, they write, and I believe you can use it to separate him from his wife, so we can question
him. His wife? You mean Sigurd's wife? I didn't know he had one.
The woman, Beryl, who pretends she's his sister, is, in fact, his wife. I believe he forces her into it.
What? That's shocking. You mean
he is our enemy state. He must be. There is no other calculus that makes any sense.
But how do you know that she is his wife?
Because he forgot himself. I did some saluting in the Times and found that a school in the north came to grief under the atrocious circumstances he described, and that the owner of the school disappeared with his wife. I'm hoping to receive a photograph soon to confirm the identity.
God, what is it?
Hush! Where is it? So where is it?
It's the lamp of picking up!
Yes, Miss Watson.
How do you do? Mr. Holmes! What a pleasure! He's expecting me for
as cool as one of his butterflies, attempting to capture them, fluttering away at the last second. Let us pray that we can catch him before his next kill. But now, quickly, we have a train to meet.
Telling me not to do
this time, you might do it safely.
If that was to say,
now, hold your carriage, or you'll be late for dinner.
Well, if you say so, but I don't like it.
We must say, Stella Hall, wasn't
it? Oh, poor Sir Henry will think me confusedly if I can manage to...
What are they? What's the matter?
These paintings on the wall are Sir Henry's ancestors.
Yes.
And all of them basketballs.
Yes, the one you're staring at, Sir Hugo. The one who started everything. Is something wrong?
No. Nothing is wrong. In fact, something is very, very right at last. Oh, I think you know. I think you know nothing. Ah, I think you'll agree. This talk is remarkable.
Well, I say it's very lifelike, but I don't know that I call it
remarkable. Why would it? Now, take a few steps back. There. Now, I want you to imagine him without the hat. Without that heavy cloak he's wearing. Without all the hair. Now, does he remind you of anyone?
Good Lord, Higgins, the Stapleton.
Same greedy little eyes. Same weak function. Same awful teeth. Good heavens.
Good heavens, praise heavens, glorious heavens. Stapleton is a basketball. He must be the black sheep's son.
Or the brother who died in South America.
When there's our motive, by killing Sir Henry, Stapleton stands to inherit everything. Oh, I should have seen it back in the Northumberland Hotel, the silly and desperate.
To me, it was missing from the very beginning. The mysterious letter, the missing food, Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
That's enough. Remind me to switch hotels.
Right. But how does Stapleton do it, Holmes? The creature is real, at least it seems to be real.
Why not? And soon he'll be fluttering in our net as helpless as one of his butterflies. Now, quickly, let's go to the station and meet the straw.
Captain.
Down the fog. And down Sir Henry. taking his time. Our success and even his life may depend on him coming out with a ball of scores everything.
Look, one of the lines went out.
Come on.
The fog's getting worse. I can barely think half an hour.
Shh. I think I can hear him coming out.
Do not. And then you again. Sleep well.
Stapleton was indeed the son of Roger Baskerville, and when he realized that only two persons intervened between him and the title,
he decided to kill them both. He settled in Devonshire for that very purpose, learned about the legend of the hand, and this is where his true genius came in. He relied on the legend to create the real thing. He used a gigantic mask, hidden, painted, and starved to do his killing. His wife tried to warn Sir Henry with her letters, and used the cutouts in case her husband never recognized her handwriting. But Stapleton was stealing Sir Henry's boot to give the hound the scent of smelling the man, which told me instantly that there was a real girl involved. So I had my suspicions before you even left for Devonshire. The one red herring in all of this was that convict victim, who actually had nothing to do with the case, but clouded my judgment for a while, which is unforgivable.
As if an answer to Holmes' self-reproach, the doorbell rang at this very instant, and Henry and Mr. Stapleton arrived to inform us that they were getting married, as soon as the alarm went out, and asking me to be their maid of honor.
Oh, excellent. This calls for celebration. Come, let's go to the opera. My box is free, and the opera's faster. Some small help, and it was a relief, however briefly, to have something worth fighting for, something to relieve the everyday humdrum routine of our mortal existence.
Plot against Queen, dynamite!
Well, Watson.
Yes, Holmes.
Appears the wheel has turned yet again. Now it's back to work.